Woods Bagot are the architects for the London Hotel, which is a new destination hotel right on Leicester Square, which is owned by Edwardian Hotels Group. Edwardian Hotels is a family-owned business, and the chairman of the company is really passionate about creating a destination hotel for Londoners. It's a legacy for him, his family, and for everyone in the city. So we're really, really excited to be working on this project with them, with Edwardian. For the last 5 years, I've been at Woods Bagot. So Woods Bagot, we started in Australia. We've moved now all around the world. We have offices in New York, in San Francisco, Dubai, all over China. So it's a really global practice, and you get to meet people from all around the world and talk with people in other studios and get inspiration and also share your expertise. So yeah, over the last 5 years, I've been actually pretty much constantly working on the Londoner Hotel, which is the project that we presented here in Kyiv. So the project is 350 bedrooms. It's got a spa, ballroom, a two-screen Odeon cinema, lots of food and beverage. So there's 6 or 7 restaurants and bars spread throughout the hotel. And one of the things that we focused on for our presentation in this technology conference is the fact that it's actually a really deep basement, like unbelievably super deep basement. We think it's the deepest habitable basement in the world. We haven't yet found any deeper, but I'm sure if there is one deeper out there, people will tell us. So the basement is about 31 meters deep. So it's quite a challenge to form this space underground, right in the center of London, so on Leicester Square, which if anyone's been to Leicester Square, it's very vibrant. Lots of tourists come through. We actually need to make sure for the hotel revenue, 50% will come from people staying there from the bedrooms, but another 50% has to be from people coming in off the street. And that's one of the main reasons why it ended up being called The Londoner, because it really is for Londoners and for people who are visiting, as well as the people who are staying there. So one of the challenges we had on this site was we wanted to fit a lot of function into this destination hotel, and our site, we had all of the buildings on one city block, which was amazing, but it meant we couldn't go any wider. It's surrounded on all four sides by road, and when people think of London, they think of very high, tall buildings, so the Shard and the Gherkin, and all these glass towers. But actually, aside from these small clusters of tall buildings, London is quite low. There's a lot of building between 3 to 9 stories. And one of the reasons why London height is capped, apart from in certain small clusters, are because of planning corridor view restrictions. So we obviously have a lot of historical buildings in London, but two in particular, so Westminster Palace and St Paul's Cathedral, it's not just the building that's protected, it's actually the sight line through the city to the building. So you basically can't build high in any of these viewing corridors, which would obstruct the view to these historical buildings. So our site, unfortunately, sits right in the middle of one of these viewing corridors. So our height was capped at 9 stories, or about 36 meters. So we're capped at the top, and we're capped at the sides, but we have huge amount of usage and function to fit into our hotel. And then you obviously have all of the back of house spaces, so staff changing rooms and staff dining and offices, and then plants. So this basically, as we were working through the usage, we realized that a 1 or a 2 or a 3 story basement was not going to fit everything that we needed into this space. And we looked to our engineers, Arup, who are luckily one of the best engineers in the world, and we said to them, really, you need to give us a super deep basement. How deep can we go and how wide can we go? And that's when the fun really started with the basement, in terms of the challenges on the site of being right in the city centre and digging such a deep basement. That took probably at least a year and a half to get to the point where Arup had worked through the design and the service diversions on the site had happened before the hole could actually start to be dug. I'm sure that Rachel from Arup will take you through the issues with digging a hole this deep. One of our big architectural decisions that we had to make were how do we get people in, and then how do we get them to experience the space vertically rather than the more traditional horizontal movement that people would usually have through a space, because essentially they're coming in halfway up the building. So for us, we used the atrium as a tool for allowing people to explore this space. Above ground, we have an open air atrium which gets light into all of the bedroom corridors and some light also onto the ground floor. At one point in the design, we had one big atrium right from the roof right down to the bottom of the basement to get light down there. But we soon realized that people would feel very overwhelmed actually if they were standing looking up essentially 60 meters to the sky, and they would feel like they are really deep underground and actually deeper than they even were. So we soon decided to split the atrium into the two experiences of the building, which is above ground, which focuses on the guests who are staying there in the hotel bedrooms, and then below ground, a separate atrium, which we had a lot of fun designing this space, because we focused on the idea of a vertical club. So you have a central spine element which has all of the front of house spaces and experiences in the basement that become accessed off of this central spine, which is going to be a really beautiful bronze sculptural staircase through this space, which will encourage people to flow vertically down the building and then come into all of the spaces that are available to them. Off of these front of house spaces, we have an amazing interior designer, Yabu Pushelburg, who works with us on this scheme. So for the front of house spaces, we actually weren't at all worried about how people experience the space underground, because the spaces are very amazingly designed finishes by Yabu, but they're also spaces that people are used to not having a window. So when you're in the cinema, obviously you don't expect to see outside, and it works amazingly for acoustics down there. In a ballroom, you also don't expect to see a window. You want to be immersed in this experience. Other restaurants and bars we have down there, we've made sure that they're really intimate and exclusive places. So again, you don't need to be seeing outside for that. You actually want to be focused on where you are and what you're eating and who you're talking with in the restaurant. So these spaces are fine, but our biggest concern in terms of having people in this basement were actually the back of house spaces, because you come to a restaurant, you're there for 2 hours and you go, it's fine. But people are pressing a button, coming down 30 meters, and they might not come out for 9 hours when they work their shift in the office. So we needed to really focus on these spaces, make sure A, they're really well lit, bright, comfortable, high-end finishes for the people that are in these spaces to enjoy being there. And we also use lighting as a tool. So we use tunable lighting which matches people's circadian rhythms. So throughout the course of the day, the lighting in these zones change to replicate what's happening outside of the building, so that when they come out at the end of their shift, their body internally is actually already adjusted to the correct time of day, because otherwise if they were in a fluorescent lit space that's one temperature, one lighting all day long, and they come out, that would actually have really quite long-term implications implications for people's health when their body isn't naturally in sync with what's going on outside, which is what can normally happen during the day if you have a window in your office. So for us, we focus on technologies like that to ensure that people's experiences so far down in the basement were healthy and were focused on their well-being. In terms of the future and architecture and architects and the skills that we're going to need to move forward, I think the conference that we've been to here is amazing for seeing all of the different things that are happening in our industry, from people looking at life on Mars to all the parametric design tools that we are now using on a daily basis. But there's so much further to go. I think as architects, we're and the built environment in general, we're very at the beginning of our journey into innovation, and unlike most other industries, there's actually nothing that has caused a big disruption. No technology that's caused the way that we do things to be completely different. And personally, I don't know if that will actually happen, because I think we're a real human industry, and it's about humans creating spaces for other humans. So it's not like a taxi driver where an Uber app can come in. But what I do really hope that we do as an industry is develop the skills to enable us, and the tools to enable us, to focus on the creative side and put all of our energies into making the best spaces possible between us and the other design consultants. So what do I think about architecture outside of the planet? I mean, I am a science fiction geek. I grew up reading science fiction books, so the idea of it I find fascinating, and some of the speakers we had this week really show what can be done if we put our minds to it. However, I can't help but think we need to sort out what is going on our own planet before we put too much effort into something that, it's out there. What about what's happening here? We have so many issues that we should be tackling and dealing with as a built environment industry and just as humans. So I kind of think it's a great idea, and I love seeing what people are doing with it, and in my head I'm going to live on Mars one day before I die, but at the same time we need to focus on what's here.